Get ready to learn a lesson from McGuire, Griffey, Ripken, and more. Major League Baseball is proud to introduce Hitters on Hitting, Finding the Sweet Spot. Some of baseball's all-time heaviest hitters reveal the inside secrets of their swing with exclusive interviews and footage not available anywhere else. The interactive DVD includes over 50 minutes of bonus material that USA Today calls pure perfection. Hitters on Hitting is available now wherever videos and DVDs are sold.
The Atlanta Braves had ventured into the postseason wars three times in the 1990s, but always seemed to come up short. Now they were back, their powerful nucleus from the left side of the plate still intact. But this time, they had added youth and spunk to the lineup. Homegrown talent, just now beginning to bear fruit. They traded for possibly the best center fielder in the National League to back up what was universally acclaimed to be the best pitching staff in baseball, led by a man who would win the Cy Young Award four consecutive years. The expanded postseason beckoned once again. First, the surprising Colorado Rockies.
The Braves a strike away from advancing, a half swing, and they'll go to Cincinnati for the National League Championship Series.
Next, the Cincinnati Reds, their bats silenced by the Braves, humbled in four straight.
Bowlers looks, and the strike two pitch to Sanders. A swing and a miss, and the Atlanta Braves have won the 1995 National League pennant. And as you can imagine, the celebration begins down on the natural surface of this ballpark.
In the American League, the amazing Cleveland Indians were a rock and roll wonder. They hit .291 as a team, led the league in runs scored, hits, and stolen bases, and had 8 300 hitters in their starting lineup. They won a Major League best 100 games and won the Central Division by 30 games, the largest first place lead in modern baseball history.
It's gone!
For the first time since they won 111 games in 1954, the Indians rocked into postseason play, where they rolled over the Boston Red Sox in the division series, three straight. Against Seattle, Cleveland beat the unbeatable Randy Johnson in Game 6 of the championship series with a sneak attack that left the Mariners demoralized. When Jose Mesa closed the door, the curse on Cleveland was no more.
The Cleveland Indians, after a 41-year wait, are in the World Series.
Presenting the 1995 World Series, featuring the Cleveland Indians and the Atlanta Braves. Both teams had high hopes to become world champions, the Indians and the Braves. And before Game 1 got underway, a chance to renew old acquaintances. But who could be happier than Atlanta rookie Chipper Jones? Well, maybe his parents, especially Dad, a college baseball coach who knew someday his son would be here.
Being a baseball man, the day that he came into this world, I had a bat and a ball, rubber bat and a rubber ball, and when we brought him home, it hung over his crib from day one. And he has always played with the bat and played with the ball around the house, and being from a small community, and him not having a whole lot of neighbors and friends around, it was he and I, Dad, come on out in the backyard, the way that dads normally play with their kids.
Chipper's still down in the line?
I can't see through the screen.
Yeah, he's down there. He's talking to Alan Emery.
The fact that he, you know, he got a press pass, he's feeling all big and everything, and you know, he gets to walk down on the field. Mom gets to come down with him. He's hobnobbing with the Dale Murphys, the Hank Aarons. They, you know, both came up to me and they were crying, just, you know, really telling me how special it was to them and what a great time they had.
Good luck. Have a good one. All right. Have a good one.
Off to his first World Series game. Veteran Oral Hershiser was 7-0 in his postseason career. His counterpart, 19-2 on the season, Greg Maddux. It was a classic Game 1 matchup, and confidence was high.
I surprised myself. I expected to be a lot more nervous than I actually was, but it was almost like you know, a game we played back in June or July.
In the stands, Chipper's parents were joined by his wife, also experiencing her first World Series game. As it began, Chipper's dad already knew the score.
I tell you, the key to this series right here is keeping this guy off base. He's a great player.
Hit down to short, and Belliard drops it, picks it up, and has no play. Belliard gets to start in place of the injured Blauser and begins the World Series with an error.
He had to go to his to his right a little bit, and I saw that, so I just took off running, and I saw him kind of bobble a little bit, and next thing I know, I was at first base.
But as Atlanta manager Bobby Cox knew all too well, Kenny Lofton had led the American League in stolen bases four straight years, and he wouldn't be on first for very long.
He goes, the pitch is strike three, and the throw is not in time.
Keeping up with the Joneses' worst fears, Lofton was commanding everyone's attention. And with one out, he had one more thing on his mind.
They can get the third somehow, some way, and that's what I was trying to do, to get the third base.
Lofton goes, the pitch is low, the throw is not in time. Jones put the glove down, the throw is right there, but Kenny Lofton steals third.
Still one out, and second baseman Carlos Baerga looked to get his first ever World Series RBI.
And he hits a soft grounder to short. It will score a run. Belliard takes care of Baerga, but the legs of Lofton create the first run of the World Series.
Although he didn't allow a hit, Maddux trailed 1-0. In the bottom of the first, Hershiser gave up a leadoff single to Marquise Grissom, and with one out, Jones made his World Series debut.
You know, this has to be a thrill for him. Gotta be a thrill.
Remember when he was being drafted?
Yeah.
Chipper Jones, given first name Larry. And he hits the 2-2 pitch on a line, and it's caught by Vizquel, who starts a 6-4 double play.
I'll tell you what, that kid's a great shortstop. Great shortstop.
Parents can find a silver lining anywhere. But while Jones was robbed in his first World Series at bat, Oral was the victim one inning later in crime dog Fred McGriff's debut.
Freddie McGriff to lead off.
Well, the first at bat, your first World Series at bat, you know, you want to get that first good swing. Just once you get that first swing, then you start loosening up. So I was telling myself, take a nice little rip. To be aggressive, and I was looking for a good pitch to hit. I know Oral throws a lot of strikes.
Fred's home run, it was supposed to be a fastball away, and I threw it right down the middle. It's just a blatant mistake, and that's the kind of hitter he is. He doesn't let you get away with anything.
The man behind McGriff, Dave Justice, also has a habit of capitalizing.
Come on, Dave, let's go back to back.
Oral would have none of it and sent Justice a gentle reminder not to get too comfortable.
Pitch inside if you want to be successful.
Wasn't even that far inside. He just overreacted.
A lot of hitters resent that.
I told him that wasn't even close.
So this ball is a purpose pitch.
But he dropped the bat. He had some good theatrics going, though.
But the real theatrics belonged to the pitchers, who for the next four innings put on a passion play of guile and finesse.
just makes it look so easy. It's a clinic. 12 straight set down by the professor.
The thing that makes him effective is that he'll throw a pitch that looks like it's in the zone, and by the time he gets there, he's got good late movement. It just...
In Chipper's second shot at Hershiser, he again would come up empty.
Lynn's over here, and every time the pitch comes, she's going...
Like you don't. You never
I've been calm tonight. I have been calm. Won.
That's grounded toward the hole. Baerga started to stumble.
Oh!
And turns in a nice play to take care of Jones. Two down.
Golly. That was
his
pick.
Maddox was keeping everything on the ground and benefiting from the glove work behind him.
That's grounded sharply to the right side. Great stop by Lefty.
Come the sixth inning, Chipper could see the writing on the wall.
When you get robbed of hits in your first two at-bats against Thurl Hershiser, you're just going to have an unlucky night.
Two balls and two strikes. The pitch is waved at and missed, and down he goes. Look at the bulldog. What a beauty. 1-1.
That made me look bad on him, and I'll remember that next time I face him.
Well, maybe. But the calm and collected Maddox wasn't even paying attention to his opposite number.
I try not to get too involved in who I'm pitching against and just try to concentrate on the hitters.
Still tied in the seventh, Orel's clock began to wind down.
I didn't really have a concept of time in that game of, you know, oh, we are now in the fifth or the sixth or where it was. It was just the fact that I needed to keep getting people out because Greg kept putting up a zero, so I needed to go out and match it. You know, I just didn't answer the bell in the seventh.
First, McGriff, as Orel's control slipped away. Two men on, nobody out. Hershiser had eclipsed 100 pitches, and during a mound conference, he felt it best that he not go on.
I was asked how I was feeling, and I told him, you know, I don't really think I have it right now. I think you need to get somebody else in here. And Mark made the change.
To left-hander Paul Ossenmacher, who compounded matters for Cleveland by loading the bases with a walk to pinch hitter Mike Devereaux.
This is absolutely amazing. You got a pitcher's duel going on. Very few hits, very few base on balls, and all of a sudden, they're loaded up, three walks.
Julian Taveras came on to face Luis Polonia, and though he would drive in a run, the Braves deserved a better fate.
Grounded to short, and it's juggled by Mescal. He gets it out there, and they score the go-ahead run. Cox is going to argue the call.
I don't think Mescal ever had control of the ball. Bruce Fremming called Devereaux out at second base because he said he was in the act of throwing. He never had control of the ball.
So it winds up as a force at second. It's 2-1 Atlanta. One out, runners at first and third. And Cox emphatically going through the signs.
And this situation has squeeze written all over it.
Chipper's dad certainly agreed.
Bunt the ball right here. Doesn't have to be a perfect bunt. Bunt it. Bunt it. Bunt it. All right. All right. All right. All right. Yeah.
All a batter has to do is make sure he gets it anywhere in fair territory. 3-1 Braves.
More than enough, it seemed, for the masterful Maddox, who had set a World Series record by allowing just two outfield outs. But with one down in the ninth, Lofton struck.
And that's it in the left field for a base hit. So Lofton with a single.
I tell you, Kenny Lofton in this postseason has been so impressive.
I wasn't going to just sit there and just let guys swing and make out. I was going to try to do something.
And with a 3-1 lead with Lofton, who can run at first, it doesn't make a whole lot of difference.
He goes, and it's grounded to the right side, and Lemke plugs up the hole, throws him out, and Lofton's going to go to third, and he's going to get away with it. It's a terrible strategic move, but he gets away with it.
Terrible. Life is full of chances, and you got to be aggressive, and I felt that these guys were taking bad swings, and you know they weren't hitting the ball good at a particular time. So if you feel that your team's not hitting the ball well, you got to do something else.
That would have been about the most embarrassing ending to a World Series game ever had Lofton been thrown out at third.
As it turned out, it's probably glad that he went ahead and scored, because that's just one less distraction on the bases. That's somebody you're not going to have to look at. I think if it does anything, it enables you to concentrate better on just the hitter, because that's all that's out there now is just the hitter.
And with two out, the only hitter remaining was Carlos Baerga.
He is phenomenal. We got to keep him off base, because the next guy on deck is like the best player. He's an American League MVP. We got to keep him off base.
Tell you, nobody in baseball that I've seen in a long, long time can carve up a lineup like Greg Maddux.
And it's popped in the air down the left field line. Strike one.
On the next pitch, Baerga sprained his ankle.
His legs look to me like they're bothering.
Carlos Baerga appears to be hurt. These swings that he's been taking have been very funky.
Kirk Gibson went up there one-legged and hit a home run in the World Series before. So, I mean, even though the guy appears to be hurt, I don't think that's going to change your approach about anything.
And Maddux is a strike away. 1-2, pop, foul, giving chase is Jones, and he makes the catch to give the Braves the win.
A 3-2 victory in Game 1, just the 15th two-hitter in World Series history, and only one word to describe Maddux.
Awesome.
Pretty awesome.
He's just awesome.
I just think that he had a game plan going in, and he worked it to perfection.
Just trying to cut it and sink it in there and, you know, throw some change-ups, whatever. I think you're doing him an injustice when you try and come up with more accolades, you know, because there's nothing else you can say about the guy that hasn't been said.
He's a great pitcher, man.
I mean, it's great to win the first game, but we got to win three more. I mean, it's just a very small step to where we actually want to be. And, you know, we may have won the battle, but we're not even close to winning the war. And I think we all understand that. It's a very good team. And just need to come out and play well tomorrow.
As Atlanta prepared for Game 2, the Braves fans could barely disguise their expectations.
I guarantee a three-hitter from Glavine tonight.
And getting a ticket was a superheroic feat.
Where's Robin? Robin's inside. I'm out here trying to get me a ticket.
The Indians' bats took a hurting in Game 1. But Greg Maddux will do that to you. Of more concern was the confidence, the swagger, of a team that's been here before. El Presidente, Dennis Martinez, was Cleveland's hope in Game 2. His first World Series start in 16 years, the longest such stretch in Major League history. His counterpart, Tom Glavine, 2-2 in series play with an impressive 2.08 ERA. The game was scoreless in the second, when Albert Bell made the first inroad against Glavine.
And the 2-1 pitch. Sounded like a broken bat, but it finds the hole for a leadoff single.
Number 33, first baseman Eddie Murray.
Eddie Murray hadn't homered off Glavine in 54 National League at-bats. Now he sought to become the third oldest man ever to hit a series home run.
Been 0-for-11 from the right side in postseason play, but he can always hammer that high fastball. Glavine makes a mistake, and Eddie Murray makes him pay for it. High fastball.
You know, I guess it was a double mistake in that it was up and it was over the plate, but you can't afford to do that too many times with this lineup. You know, I'm certainly not thinking that a two-run home run in the second inning is going to be the difference in the ball game, because, you know, I've got confidence in our offense, and there's still a long way to go from that point.
An assumption that had merit, for the Braves would go on to tie the game at 2. As the night progressed, the 40-year-old Martinez began to tire. With one out in the sixth and Dave Justice on third, he faced Atlanta's leading hitter in 1995, catcher Javier Lopez, who had a plan.
I saw the infield coming in, and the first thing is going through my mind was trying to hit the ball hard. If I don't hit the ball hard, at least try to hit the ball to the outfield.
Fastball bounced foul, and it's 0-2.
Very good pitch there by Martinez. That was a sinker down and in. He wants to keep the ball down so he can get a ground ball to one of his infielders. I like this young hitter. I think he'll get the job done.
There's been a few games during the regular season that I've been a hero. You know, the last inning, getting the base hit to win the game. I don't get too nervous, and I try to concentrate as much as I can. That way I can do the job and celebrate after that.
Another 1-2 pitch. Sidearm again in the air to deep center. This at least gets a run home, maybe more. Lofton will watch it leave. That ball just kept on carrying, and Lopez continues to be a clutch performer in the postseason, snapping the 2-all tie, and the Braves lead it 4-2.
After two more hits, Martinez was through.
Dennis struggled, you know, really the entire game. Now, that doesn't mean that Dennis wasn't still very effective, because Dennis struggling is better than a lot of pitchers when they're on the top of their game. He did struggle, but he did keep us in the ball game and allowed us a chance to win.
Martinez had pitched 5 2/3 innings, and after allowing 3 hits in 6 innings, Glavine also left the game. The Indians scratched out another run in the 7th to close the gap to 4-3. However, Cleveland's comeback hopes were dealt a severe blow in the 8th, when with one out, the second hit of the game by Manny Ramirez put him on first, but not for long.
You see Lopez indicate with his index finger. That means he wants it away from Tommy. If he puts down one with his little finger, he wants it inside. Let's see what he does here. Fastball inside.
A throw in to first base, and they got him. Ramirez with the mistake of a youngster in a World Series game, straying off first.
That was a planned pickoff play, though. You saw the sign by Javier Lopez inside, and then he gave him the fist, like you're really pumping in there.
In that moment, I gave it the sign, and he was ready to cover the first base. You know, I called that fastball in because I thought with two strike, he's probably going to swing that pitch inside. And my thought was strike him out and throw him out in first base. But now that he took that pitch, at least he gave me a chance to throw him out in first base.
And that's exactly what he did, snuffing out the Cleveland rally before it got started. Come the 9th inning, Atlanta called on number one reliever Mark Wohlers, who got 2 quick outs and looked to make shortstop Omar Vizquel his final victim.
Vizquel is hitless. And that's through for a hit as Wohlers tried to bear him. No throw. A single could tie this game. Again, the 3-2. And this one is popped up. It's Chipper Jones. And it's 2-0 Atlanta.
A swing and a fling. The hero with both his bat and his arm. Catcher Javier Lopez. Surely a game he'll never forget. So too Wohlers, who fully understood the magic of the moment.
It's a dream come true to get a save in the World Series when there's 26 other teams sitting at home watching. You know, you're the best team in the National League, playing for your league, playing for your team, playing for your family, playing for yourself. And to get that last out and just to hear the roar of the fans in Atlanta, you know, celebrate and see the guys run out there and celebrate. It's a feeling you really can't explain.
And so it was on to Cleveland, a city proud of its renaissance, a city in love with its tribe.
Oh,
41 years of frustration were over.
My dad had tickets to the Game 5 of the 54 series and didn't get to go, so this is really special to be here with him tonight.
And at home, Cleveland was an amazing 58-19.
Jacobs Field, this is where the magic is.
When they're on our turf, we win.
Comeback team, cardiac cues.
All signs pointed to a Cleveland comeback. For the Indians and Jacobs Field have had a love affair since 94. This was Cleveland's secret weapon, the Jake, their ace of spades.
You're here at the World Series.
That's right. Mom, I'm at the World Series.
We hope you enjoy your visit to the ballpark.
The Braves called on postseason veteran John Smoltz for Game 3, and the Indians countered with Charles Nagy, playing in his first postseason. Charles was in charge of keeping the Braves from taking a daunting three-game lead. But with two out in the first, that rookie struck again.
Left center field, Lofton and Bell in pursuit. One bounce against the wall. Chipper Jones, who doubled in the first in Atlanta in Game 2, does the same here.
Boy, that Chipper, man.
Jones is second, two down. And McGriff lines one toward the right field corner. Ramirez won't get it. Jones is going to score. The Braves are on the board. McGriff will stop at first.
That's not good. Not good.
But at Jacobs Field, no lead is safe.
The Indians have only 8 hits through the first 2 games. Lofton has 2 of them.
Lofton's leadoff single in the bottom of the first further energized the Cleveland crowd.
Come on over, move him over. Move him over, Omar.
Not going. And a drive toward the right field corner. Big trouble if it's fair, which it is. Lofton loses his helmet as he speeds around third. Discal wants a triple as Lofton scores. And Omar is in there.
Omar would score to make it 2-1 Cleveland. And in the bottom of the third, Smoltz ran into trouble once again. This time, a leadoff double by Lofton put him in scoring position. Now, Vizquel was asked to move him over. But Omar got more than he bargained for.
Not going, Vizquel bunts. A terrific bunt if it stays fair, which it does. Runners at the corners with nobody out. Mayorga, an RBI ground out his first time up.
After I pop out twice, you know, the first 2 games, you know, to finish the game, it was kind of hard for me. So that happened, you know, and I said to myself, I need to help this team, you know, to win this game, and I want to get a base hit, you know, at least to get a chance for RBI to bring another RBI.
One more pitch.
What they needed now was for the big man to chime in.
Two on, still nobody out, and here's Bell. This is the guy that they've got to get going. I don't know how they're going to do it, but this is the guy that the Indians really have to have. Hit hard toward the middle. It's through. Vizquel is going to score. An RBI for Bell. 4-1 Cleveland.
Unexpectedly, Smoltz was gone after 2 1/3 innings.
Serenaded, if that's the word, by Ray Charles. Hit the road, Jack.
Coach, come back no more, no more, no more, no more. Hit the road, Jack. Coach, come back no more.
Cleveland fans were giddy, especially with a relief pitcher coming on who was somewhat unprepared.
I didn't have time to think about anything, so I didn't know who was coming up. I didn't know what the situation was. I didn't know how many people were on base, and so I came in onto the field, and I walked down, and I noticed that the bases were loaded, and I looked up scoreboard. It was 4-1 and one out, and I was like, man, here we go again.
Well, they brought in Brad Klotz because he can get the ground ball. He is a sinker ball pitcher.
I didn't even have time to think what his strengths are and how we're supposed to pitch him. I'm just going to throw my strengths. I'm going with my sinker, keep it away from him. I know he's a dead red fastball hitter, and he's going to be looking for something he can drive. You know, especially in a situation where he can put the game out of reach.
And the 1-2 pitch. Hit hard, but a double play ball. Lemke to the bag himself, and the throw to complete it. Quantz comes in to get a double play ball. That's what he does.
A 4-1 lead, but an opportunity missed. Meanwhile, Maggie was cruising and escaped trouble in the fifth when he caught Grissom trying to steal third. But two bad pitches in the course of the next two innings cost him dearly.
McGriff drives one to right. Ramirez turns and watches this one go out. So now the Braves are within two. On the first pitch, as we go to the seventh, Ryan Klesko with an opposite field home run. So solo homers by McGriff and then Klesko have made this a one-run game.
In the bottom of the seventh, Lofton walked, one of six times he'd reached base in this game. He moved to second on a ground out and with two down, stole third. The Tribe looked to Carlos to get back a run.
Dancing down the line at third as the pitch comes home to Baerga. Hit toward the hole. Mordecai from the outfield grabs. Can't throw as he slips. And the speed of Lofton produces a run.
With a 5-3 lead at home, the Indians had to feel confident. But some folks were surprised that the eighth inning pitcher was still nagging. Hargrove had his reasons.
He had only thrown 81 pitches, 83 pitches, something like that. That's a fairly low pitch count. And we felt he was throwing well. He said he felt fine. Charlie had really handled Grissom and Polonia all night long, and there was no reason for us to believe it wouldn't continue.
Grissom swings on the first pitch. Ramirez sprinting back and right, and this ball hits the top of the wall. Grissom on his way to second and in with a leadoff double.
I think they left him in one pitch too long. I think he'll take him out now.
We didn't want to start the inning with the left-hander because we knew that if Grissom did get on, that they would pinch hit probably Devereaux, and Devereaux can hit the ball at the ballpark where Polonia is not likely to do that.
Polonia's 0-3. And Sorrento can't get it. It's by the diving first baseman. Grissom is waved home. RBI single for Polonia.
Indeed. It was Assenmacher who came on, and Polonia immediately stole second. Chipper Jones then walked, and a deep fly ball by McGriff allowed both runners to advance. One out, 5-4 Cleveland.
A base hit could give them the lead by Erga. Boots it. Does he recover in time? No, safe. The game tied, and runners at the corners. Still only one out.
That brought on Julian Taveras to face pinch hitter Mike Devereaux, hoping for his first World Series hit.
I was telling myself not to make myself nervous at all, but the all fun part of being in the World Series is the fact that, hey, this is pretty exciting. This is going to be the most important at bat in my entire career.
The 1-0 pitch is hammered into left center field. It gets down for a base hit. The Braves have taken the lead.
Though a spectacular double play pivot by Vizquel prevented further harm, the damage was done, and Cleveland fans were stunned, trailing now 6-5. But in the bottom of the eighth, Wohlers came in with two on and one out. 50 times, Cleveland came back to win in 95. Why not 51?
So the batter is Sandy Alomar Jr. First and third, one out. On the first pitch, he hits it between McGriff and the bag. The game is tied. Kirby, the pinch runner, the third. Alomar on his way in with a double, and he pumps his fist as he gets there.
Alomar's well-placed double had tied the game at six, but Wohlers got the next two outs. Atlanta had played its relief ace, and in the ninth, so did Cleveland. Jose Mesa came on for his first ever World Series appearance. A showdown was at hand.
Mesa, I mean, 46 out of 48. You don't think the guy's ever going to give up a run.
Oh, no! To deep right. And Ramirez will have to play it off the wall. And Lemke's going to be held to a single.
We were hitting Mesa around pretty good, really. I mean, there's some balls really cracked.
Two on, two out of the ninth. Hit hard, and Perry scoops it up. preserving the tie.
Harry was brought in for defensive purposes, and he made the play of the game.
I enjoyed it. I mean, that was probably one of the best moments I've had. It was incredible. I mean, the feeling coming off. The field, 50,000 people standing on their feet yelling and screaming, that's the best field.
Broken bat, slow roller, Mordecai has to charge, throws on the run and gets it.
It was just like an old duel, you know, like in the old West or something like that. The two best pitchers in baseball out there going at one.
A high-stakes poker game that Cleveland couldn't afford to lose.
This is an exciting game from the Atlanta dugout. It's a gut-wrenching game in this dugout. Up the middle. Bayerga's at least able to stop it. Can he throw him out? Yes!
Cleveland came oh so close in the bottom of the 10th.
Now we're in the 10th. Lofton goes. They don't contest it. It's hit up the middle. Lemke gets Vizquel in first. Two men are left. On to the 11th.
The man was tough, and I trying to be tough to compare to the guy, you know, because the man is a hard throwing like 100 last night.
When Mesa answered the call in the 11th inning, it marked his longest outing of the year. But could he have gone more than three?
Yeah, I can go longer, but they don't want me to go farther because they're thinking about tomorrow. But sometime in this area, you know, you cannot thinking about tomorrow. You got to thinking about today, and that's it.
Bouncing ball by Erga. This guy. And now they give themselves another chance to win.
When Alejandro Peña relieved Wohlers in the bottom of the 11th, he immediately ran into trouble against the man who had made the final out in the first two games.
Bayerga smacks one into right center field. This is going to split the outfielders and go to the wall. Bayerga doesn't run that well, and he's content to stop at second base.
The Braves walked Bell intentionally and set the stage for the future Hall of Famer, Eddie Murray.
In that inning, I just say, Eddie gonna have it right here. He was 0 for 5. You know, he looked bad at the play, and I say, no, he gonna step up, he gonna do it, and he got a line drive right away.
He lines it in the center. Here comes the pinch runner, Espinosa. The Indians are back in the World Series.
Final score, 7-6, and a classic World Series game.
When it's over with, it was fun to be a part of. When it's going on, it's pretty much torture. You don't have a whole lot of time to sit back and enjoy it.
It's hard to lose. I'd rather get beat 25-0 than lose a tough game. Even when we go on and win this thing, I'll remember that game because it was tough. And game could have gone either way. You know, they were due for a few breaks, I guess.
There's no team that's ever come back from being down 3-0. There haven't been many that have come back from being 2-0, but we gave ourselves a chance, and that's all we asked for, is just a chance.
Before game four, bubbles dotted the Cleveland landscape.
Okay, this is the Bubblehead Club in honor of Alvaro Espinosa and his pranks in the dugout, sticking a bubble unsuspectingly on teammates' hats.
Everyone was in the pink when these bubblicious good luck charms worked in game three for fans who'd rather pop than chop.
The Atlanta Tomahawk Chop's getting kind of old, so we figured we'd come up with something fresh here in Cleveland. Another bubblehead member.
On the hill for Cleveland in game four, Ken Hill, hoping for some good luck of his own. His mission? Keep Atlanta leadoff hitter Marquise Grissom off the base path. But on Hill's first pitch, Grissom singled to center field. And Bobby Cox figured it was a good time to force the issue.
And there goes Grissom, and the first pitch is a strike, and the throw is a one-hopper that is not in time.
Right fielder,
with two on and two out, Justice sought to shake his series doldrums. Hargrove liked the matchup, with Justice 1 for 25 lifetime against Hill.
And that's grounded to Vizquel softly. To Baerga for the force. And Atlanta squanders a threat in the first.
The Braves countered with Steve Avery over Maddox, a choice that begged an answer from Bobby Cox.
And it was the smart thing to do, was pitch Ave. And I told him, man, no matter what our record, probably he would pitch the fourth game no matter what. And the other thing was, Avery was throwing great. So when a guy's throwing great, I don't think that there's any question what you should do.
Avery pitched shutout ball through the first five innings. In fact, he allowed the Tribe only two hits. And his smooth, effective outing made Cox look like a genius.
Belliard is there to field back of second and throw him out.
Well, so far you can't second guess Bobby Cox going with this young man.
No.
Steve Avery.
In the top of the sixth, Ryan Klesko sought to break the scoreless tie. For up to now, Hill was matching Avery pitch for pitch.
That's drilled to right field and out of here.
Split finger fastball, and it's a rocket to right.
Klesko's second home run in as many nights gave Atlanta a 1-0 lead. But the hardy Cleveland fans had hardly given up hope.
We're gonna do it right now! We're starting it, and here it comes! Showtime in Cleveland, Ohio, World Series! Let's do it now!
The beleaguered Carlos Baerga had hit into a double play in the bottom of the sixth. And that left matters up to Albert Bell.
They gotta have Albert hit one out of here. Albert's gotta hit the ball in the air.
Avery worked him away.
A walk and a strikeout for Bell tonight, and Avery hasn't given him one decent pitch to hit.
But as Cox knew only too well, Albert can make even outside pitches disappear.
It's the World Series! It's 4th and 1! 4th and 1 on the goal line, Albert!
Hit down the right field line and deep and into the corner, and it is gone!
Touchdown, his first of the series.
4-1! Wow!
But the Indians weren't quite through. Walks to Murray and Ramirez put two men on with two out, and Avery now faced first baseman Herbert Perry.
Come on, Herbert!
Buoyed by the mini comeback, Cleveland fans made a wish. Keep the Braves off the warpath. But with one out, Grissom walked, and Hargrove stuck with Hill against a pesky left-hander.
Left fielder number 17, Luis Polonia.
Hindsight is 20-20.
That's hit in the air to right center field, and racing over is Ramirez, and he can't make the play. Grissom around third being waved in and scores to give Atlanta the lead on a double by Polonia.
But Ted and Jane's excellent adventure had yet to run its course. For now, Cleveland called on the left-handed Assenmacher. And now it was Cox who liked the matchup this created. For after Chipper Jones walked and both runners advanced, Assenmacher faced Justice, a 400 lifetime hitter against him. Question was, did Justice know this?
No, actually, I didn't even know that. I've always thought of Assenmacher as a quality lefty, and you know, with a good slider and a good fastball, so I didn't know about my success against him.
Well, he was soon to find out. But first, he fell behind 0-2, and Cleveland fans had hopes of keeping it a one-run game.
Not every pitch is designed to get hitters out. That was a show-me fastball for the breaking ball that's coming next.
You know what? It's the World Series! Stand out!
And that's grounded into center field for a base hit. Polonia comes in to score, and so does Jones to make it 4-1.
The two-run single had broken the spirit of the hometown fans.
Nice hitting, Justice.
It became 5-1 in the ninth. And even though he worked three innings the night before, Atlanta called on Wohlers, who quite simply didn't have it. Home run Ramirez. But Wohlers wasn't fazed.
As a matter of fact, when he came into the game, every pitch was clocked faster than the night before. The only problem was that he was getting it down the middle, and he wasn't changing speeds, and it didn't look like he was going to, so I thought we better get somebody else in.
That somebody was Pedro Borbón Jr., who hadn't pitched in nearly 3 weeks, but knew this was going to happen.
I was telling my wife a couple of days ago, I said, look, I had this dream that I'm gonna come in there and save one of these games, and I think it's gonna be the last game to win it, but it didn't, it wasn't the last game to win it, but I think my dream came true.
I think he's got a lot of guts to make this move. I do too.
One man on, nobody out, Atlanta leading 5-2.
Hold strike three.
Come on, Sandy!
Next, he fanned Alomar.
Oh.
One more out and Pedro's dream would have a happy ending.
I was on a mission and my mission was to get Wallace out of that trouble right there and get my team a win.
And that's lined to right field and backing up and making the catch is Justice. Walked and smoking it to right field. Wohler's the first guy out of the dugout. A star is born right there. Pedro Borbón Jr. pitching for the first time in 19 days. With the crowd in a frenzy, and he stills them in Cleveland.
I just got 3 outs, okay? It's not that big of a deal. But I start thinking about it, and it was a big deal.
Down 3-1, the outlook wasn't brilliant for the Cleveland nine this day, especially with the mighty Maddox standing in their way. But they had seen him before, and now had a plan, thanks to hitting coach Charlie the Man.
Some of our guys were going to move closer to the plate. What this did was we felt like he had cut down the area that he could throw the ball in, and also we were going to make him jam us, and we were going to try to hit the ball to opposite field, and even if we had to stay inside out.
Good hitting, you have to adjust. He stood well off the plate early in this World Series, especially against Maddox. He has moved up. He's a little bit closer. And he hits it in the air down the right field line and into the corner. And just like last night, goes same spot.
Bell's first inning two-run homer followed the manual plan to perfection. Next, Eddie Murray.
Albert hits the home run, which is huge energy that we've kind of broken the invincible Greg Maddox. Then Eddie gets knocked down, and that's even more energy. Like, we had the fire of a two-run homer, and now the fire and the intensity of, we really want to beat these guys now.
Those hook shots and Maddox are very calm in that whole thing. Two choir boys in the middle of a riot.
I just asked him, hey, were you throwing at him on purpose? And Greg said, no, I was trying to jam him. And I said, well, you're better than that. Kind of in a connotation meaning, you know, if you're going to come into somebody, it doesn't have to be at their head. And, you know, I have a lot of respect for Greg, tremendous amount of respect. And I know he probably wasn't trying to hit Eddie and hurt him, but he definitely was trying to knock him down. This guy, he can throw a ball in a teacup. So the ball, you know, the teacup was a little higher than I would appreciate it being thrown at my player.
On the strength of a surprising Luis Polonia home run, the Braves got one back. And as the game moved to the bottom of the fourth, Eddie Murray gained a small measure of revenge.
That's lined and caught, and what a play by Maddox. That's it, as good as it gets.
I'll tell you, a certain amount of solace for Eddie Murray also after being knocked down. Now he knocks Maddox down.
Hershiser and Maddox, the sequel, was shaping up as expected. But Oro's 2-1 lead became endangered in the fifth. A single, an error, and an intentional walk loaded the bases with one out, and the always dangerous Grissom was at the plate.
And it's a little chopper to the left of the mound, and Hershiser won't have any play, as it turns out. The only play he would have had, the way that ball was hit, would have been a 1-2 force at home, and now the game is tied, and the bases remain loaded.
Polonia comes up, we just hit a home run off me, and I'm hoping that I can get a ground ball, and a ground ball hard enough, because this guy's fast, hitting from the left side. Unfortunately, hits a bullet at Omar and gets us out of the inning. That was absolutely a huge point in the game because Maddox, starting to get the feel for things, goes out there with a lead. We're in big trouble.
Still, the game was now tied 2-2, and time for the Indians was running out. But Baerga laced a double off Maddox with one out in the sixth,
setting the stage for some Jacobs Field magic. They walked Bell on purpose and brought Murray to the plate. Murray flied out, putting runners on second and third.
Come on, Jim, get aggressive. Come on, Jim. Hit one hard somewhere.
Tomei's proud parents looked on.
I was looking for something off speed. I wasn't looking for a fastball. I was looking for something off speed, and he threw a changeup, and actually, I don't think he put the ball where he wanted to put it.
And it's lined back.
Next, Manny Ramirez.
And that one's hit into right field to make it 4-2 by Ramirez.
For just the third time all season, Maddux had allowed four runs in a game. Now the hometown fans could focus on Hershiser.
Swinging and lining a base hit into left field. So Mordecai with a single here in the eighth inning to lead things off. And Marquise Grissom comes up. And will there be a visit? Hargrove remains in the dugout.
And they don't have anybody warming up at the bullpen that can induce a double play like Hershiser. Mm-hmm.
And that's a liner caught by Hershiser. Throws to first. They got it for the double play. What a play.
Finally, I used my glove for something good in this game. I was just yelling, take that, take that.
Well, this may be a ticket to Atlanta right here. Bulldog has him in a frenzy.
Yeah! Not here! Not here!
Not here indeed. With Cleveland leading 4-2 in the bottom of the eighth, it was Tomei time once again.
Come on, Jim, don't be afraid to hit it to left.
Come on, Jimmy, put the nail in the coffin.
The deep center field where it's 4-0-5 and gone.
Get out of here, get out
a lot of good feelings in my life, but nothing ever to that, you know? And being in a World Series game and to do that in that situation is just a big thrill, and it had to be even more of a thrill for him.
Now in the top of the ninth, a chance for Jose Mesa's wife to celebrate in anticipation of her husband locking this game up. Mesa saved a major league high 46 games in 95 and allowed just one earned run at Jacobs Field. But Ryan Klesko, with one on and two out in the ninth, gave the Indians cause to pause.
To right field and deep, and it is gone. One strike away, Klesko hits one out. It is 5-4, and they're going to wring every last ounce of emotion out of this crowd tonight. 5-4 with two out on the ninth.
Mesa got two quick strikes on the patient Mark Lemke, and Jacobs Field begged for one more chance to celebrate.
Back to Georgia.
Let's face it, going to Atlanta, I mean, they're going home. They need one game to win it all. And if we win this next game, we'll win it all. I believe that. And this next game is going to be the biggest game of, I think, everybody's career.
We came up here and we played pretty dang well. Made things tough on them. Now they got to go into a hostile environment
and beat us twice in our own backyard. Hats off to them if they do it. I don't think they will.
Back in Atlanta, Braves fans were hoping for deliverance from their past World Series woes.
It's over tonight. It's over tonight.
We'll see. It's not over yet.
Chief on everyone's mind was winning the game. But for one Brave in particular, there was some damage control to be done. Prior to the game, Dave Justice challenged the fans to get behind the Braves with a bit more fervor.
It wasn't a matter of me trying to lash out at the fans or say I don't appreciate them. It was just a matter of me basically saying that, you know, I haven't felt like they've been behind us like I've seen them in the past.
The tone was set. Let the game begin.
Woo! Go Braves!
Dennis Martinez returned to the mound for game six. And quite frankly, he wasn't sharp. In the bottom of the second, he walked the first two batters he faced. But his savior, once again, was his defense.
Back through the middle. Vizquel flags it down. The glove flip to Baerga and on to first to get the diving Belliard on a gorgeous double play.
Yes, sir. I think that's ball two. Ball two.
A couple of walks in the end don't hurt Martinez because his defense bails him out.
But in the other dugout, the powerful Indians were being rendered helpless by the Braves' magnificent maestro on the mound, who, as the night wore on, conducted a five-measure masterpiece of no-hit baseball. Bravo, bravo. A virtuoso performance by Tom Glavin. But still a scoreless game. In the bottom of the fifth, the gutsy Martinez was gone. Hargrove called on left-hander Jim Poole with two on and two out. Poole got two quick strikes on cleanup hitter Fred McGriff as fans in two cities held their breath.
Yeah! On three pitches, he ends the threat. Hargrove's move pays off.
Could Cleveland be held hitless in a World Series game? Not if 15-year veteran Tony Peña had his way, leading off the sixth.
It's softly in the shallow center, and it drops in front of Grissom.
There goes the no-hitter.
But still, the Indians failed to score at the hands of Glavin. It seemed like no one would score until the bottom of the sixth, when sweet irony surfaced and Justice brought back any fans still not on his side.
A long drive to right. Ramirez turns to the track. She's gone. Dave Justice, all is forgiven in Atlanta.
Bob, it's okay to talk the talk if you can walk the walk.
Prime time, Justice. Or is it serve?
Well, in fact, Justice prevailed into the ninth, where after eight innings of one-hit ball, Glavin gave way to Wolvers. Just three outs separated Atlanta from its first sports championship and the fifth one-hitter in series history.
Let's go, Braves! Let's go, Braves! Let's go, Braves!
Cleveland hadn't lost 1-0 in 566 games. But Lofton's leadoff effort would be thwarted by the Atlanta Brave defense.
A blooper in foul ground, Belliard racing over, backhanded grab!
It's one! Arrive! Woo!
He is their defensive specialist, and that's why Bobby Cox said, I always hate to take Rafael Belliard out of the ballgame for a pinch hitter.
Mike Hargrove can't afford to leave his shortstop in. He'll send up Sorrento, a 25 home run man, hopeful that Wohlers makes a mistake and Sorrento can tie it. Center field, Grissom, lots of room. One out away. the most feared offense in baseball all year long, held to one hit through 8 2/3 by Glavin and Wohlers. Baerga is 0-3. Left center field, Grissom on the run. The team of the 90s has its world championship.
The Braves are the world champs.
I just want to say we love baseball a lot, and we worked hard, and we deserve it.
Yeah.
And we're going to enjoy it.
Marky!
Oh, thank you.
And this has been a long time coming. You know, this organization, these group of guys have worked so hard to get here, and we've come up short. And that bitterness of losing these World Series games is real fresh in everybody's mouth.
It was our time. We had put in enough work, we had suffered enough, and it was time for our city and for our ball club and for this organization to get one.
You want to win it for so many people, but our team wanted to win it for us. I mean, it's a selfish reason, only because of what we've been through. Nobody understands what this team has been through. I mean, the media attention, the media tortures, and you know, everybody tried for so long to pry in, break up, and we came through, and now we can be considered one of the best teams. It's just not fair when you're in a World Series, you're either a choker or a champion. I don't understand that. So they can say all they want now about who's a postseason player and who isn't. We got a World Championship under our belt.
It was a magnificent season for both teams. Cleveland won 109 games for a whole new generation of adoring fans. And Atlanta finally shed the shackles of the past. More than 600,000 turned out to honor the new champions of baseball.
Until you are, but this is great. We're happy for these people, and happy everybody came out here to celebrate with us.
Well, it's fantastic. It's great. So happy for these fans.
Great turnout. The fans showing us how they feel. We in turn can give it back to them, and it's just a great feeling.
Indeed, a feeling that will last a lifetime. For there's something very special about the World Series, win or lose. You've made it to the top.
We're a people bound together by a single heart and mind. Like none who've gone before us or those we've left behind. We'll take the time, the sweat and tears, to soar to worlds on high and make the goals set, and then we'll pass them by. We're reaching for the top, no limit to what we can do. And all together, me and you, we're gonna see it through somehow. We're reaching for the top, the goal is set, we're pressing on. It's a hunger that we're sharing, and a thirst we all possess, that keeps us moving upward in search of sweet success. We know the task. the top.
The wind and the pitch, here it is. Swung, fly ball deep left center. Grissom on the run. Yes. The Atlanta Braves have given you a championship. The Atlanta Braves have brought the first championship to Atlanta. Tom Glavin, one of the most courageous pitching performances in World Series history, and Mark Wohlers, as he's done all year long, able to close the deal. It's over.
Fly ball left field. Back goes Grissom. Still going back. He's there. The game is over. The Atlanta Braves have won the World Series. The Atlanta Braves are the champions of all of baseball.
Left center field. Grissom on the run. The team of the 90s has its world championship.
Thank you.